Which I'm usually in trouble, so.
Can you feel it?
Yeah, right there.
Alan's always telling me, if you're not getting in trouble, you're not doing your job. I do not very well. How's your son doing? Yeah, I think his son insists him. How's your son doing?
My son doing good.
Is he still living up there? Or did he move away?
Get the light up there. There we go. Yeah, when we show the video, kill the one up front. And that's all.
Okay, kill the one up front.
Right.
Am I in your way? No.
Not at all. Not at all.
I'm here to Royal's reception, and I'm kind of like Dr. Cannon. This should be reversed. He should be given the welcome for me instead of me giving it for him. But anyway, it's really hard to know what to say. We've been working together for 20-some years, and he said this morning he remembered when I called him. I remember when I first met him, and some of you may not know the person that introduced me to Royal. Her name is Narciva Getty. And if you know Narciva, and then I was in Jackson at a meeting, and Narciva said, you've got to come meet this guy. He's over at the governor's office, and he was working for Ray Mavis at the time, and I was going, Narciva, I'm in a hurry. And Narciva's like, no, you've got to come meet this guy. I said, Narciva, today? And she said, yes. And tell me who he is. Well, he's working for, he's in charge of the disability, the council for the state of Mississippi, and I said, all right, what's his name? And she said, Royal Walker. And I said, what? She said, Royal Walker. I said, Royal. And so we met, and I left that meeting, and I said, man, where did that guy come from? And he was just, his presence was just, I knew then he was, you know, just the person that he is, nice and kind and open, and you probably don't even remember that meeting. Narciva is just off the wall.
Oh,
you just have to know.
He has a presence.
And so from then on, we met at the council. We met several times, and I told him, Narciva, I said, this guy's going to come work for us. And I kept telling Royal, when the Democrats leave and the Republicans come in, then it's time for you to come to USM. And that's just about exactly what happens. And we've been going back and forth from Republican to Democrat for years now, haven't we? So, but I wish Royal well. When I hired Royal, we really needed a policy person with IDS, and he has certainly fulfilled that role and more, much, much more, not only policy at the state level, but at the national. Someone called me, and when he sent out the announcement, asked me if he was working for President Obama, and I said, yeah, he's the new chief of staff. So anyway, but I'm going to miss you a lot, and you've been a friend for many years, and so I know y'all are all missing, and really appreciate all you've done. And, really make proud. Dr. Cannon's already given some remarks, so...
Well, I don't have a whole lot to say, and I certainly don't have the history that you have, but Roy and I started working together about 2.5 years ago when I took this job. And I think we'd done a couple times beforehand, but we never had really worked together. And it was sort of a meeting in a trial of fire, wasn't it? Because we were up at IHL, and we were getting our panties chewed out. But we made that work, one thing I learned about Royal is that he will get things to work out, always. And so it's been a pleasure to work with him the last 2.5 years. He'll tell you it's the truth. I wouldn't take his phone call for about 2 weeks, a couple of weeks ago, because he said, you know, I'm thinking about maybe retiring like we talked about. And so he called and I said, no problem. I'm not talking. So enjoy your new phase. We certainly got an issue, but don't forget about us. I mean, we're not that far away, and we'll still be in Jackson, and we'll be stopping by to see you and whatnot. You should stop by to see us when you get.
Thanks. It's been great work.
when she gets herself hired, we'll worry about it.
I've already got that written down, how I can bribe Buck and his daughter to hire me. And all the rest of us, we all gonna go do horses.
Well, you guys.
She's like an Olympian rider, I mean.
Not yet, but she's getting there.
Close. And then he has another daughter who's a ballerina and a great dancer.
Maybe we could get him to start equestrian therapy.
Well, you know, there was one in Jackson for a long time, and I worked with them, and you know, the university used to have an equestrian center.
Why did we lose that?
It starts with a big L and ends with a ability.
Liability.
Thank Cassie and Heather for putting this together and getting everything together. Y'all did a great job. And Dr. Lucas is on his way, so, Dr. Lucas was the president at the time that Roy was hired to work for the Institute. So, and y'all, you may not know, but we are here because of Dr. Lucas and because of his staff, because at the time, Ann can tell you this history too. When I first started here, we were split. It was the university affiliated program, and we had a program here at USM, one at Ellisville State School, I can believe that, one at Ole Miss, and at and in Jackson. And when Andy Bacon-Prue, who was the director at the time, left, we felt like it needed to be consolidated at one university. Well, Ole Miss, not to cut down Ole Miss, Ole Miss wanted this program so bad. Yeah. And Dr. Lucas fought for us to get it here. So we've been here for many years since then. And now, hopefully we'll be here that many years more.
Yeah.
So anyways, when you see Dr. Lucas, you can thank him because he really put his what I want to use. He put a lot out there to get it away from Ole Miss, to keep Ole Miss from getting it. So. And Dr. Kahneman would say, wow, why didn't you let it go?
I'm about to try to get Dr. Kamali. He wanted to say something, I think. I'm going to try to get him on FaceTime.
Wonderful.
You all can come on in. Miss Susie, Miss Delafaye, Miss Vicky, all of y'all.
Congratulations on your
say overall, USM has been good for me.
I still remember that 5:30 call I got from Dr. Lucas. And Jane had already kind of prepped me. And I'm going, I don't know, and Dr. Kent, I didn't even have a job. I had announced that I was leaving the gaming commission about 2 weeks after my wife told me we were pregnant with our second daughter, and I missed so much of Chrissy's years, the first year, and I just didn't see doing that again to my family. So I decided that I would leave and put them first. And announced that I was leaving, and I was getting ready, as a matter of fact, getting ready to go to Hungary for some training on that with municipal governments, another colleague from the University of Ohio. And Dr. Lucas called me, and again, I was always intrigued about what, at that time, the center was doing, because I think we got institute status about a year after I came here. And it has been a tremendous ride and journey, you know. You know, it says go through the valley, and we've been through the valleys, we've been up the peaks, and this organization, I feel, is really solid. And it's solid because, not because of Royal Walker, but it's solid because of people who are here and people who've been here. You know, I think about Stella when I came here. And we have been through a real bonding process, both, you know, supporting each other both here at work and outside of work. And, that kind of spirit has kept us very, very strong. I don't know what else, you know, for one rare time, I'm kind of speechless out in terms of what to say. Everybody here has contributed some way to my life. And, you know, it really is about, what the Bible says, we go through this journey touching other people in a good way. And I've been touched by all y'all in a very, very good way. And the thing now is to pass it on. It is a time for a new season in my life. Dr. Cannon doesn't remember the first time Dr. Cannon, I digress a little. The first time I really met you, Dr. Cannon, talked to Dr. Cannon, was over the phone. And he was yelling. You're always getting stuff in late. I'm not signing it. So I went over there and, you know, Dr. Cannon, please. And he, I'm going to do it this time. And he has been supportive of IDS. And I'm going to tell you guys in a real way, he doesn't ask for a lot of credit, but he's been very, very supportive of IDS in terms of this organization maintaining its strength and moving forward. And so I want to publicly thank him. I want to thank also Dr. Kennedy, thank the president for his recommitment to IDS and the Institute. It plays a critical part. And guys, let me say that it has nothing to do with me, but this Institute has a great national reputation. And then, as a person, though, I want to thank Jane Sykes. Jane and I have been through a lot of battles together. And we've also been through a lot of good times together.
We've had many conversations
that
you wouldn't believe.
Yeah, it's been some real, you know, sometimes, but it was always done in terms of love, and it was always done in what we thought was best for the Institute. Overall, both at a national, state, and local level. And I want to tell you a story about my first travel trip with Jane. Stella, Valerie, all had warned me, but at least after four martinis later, Dr. Kennedy, I got on the plane. After that being the second week on the job. But Jane, I want to publicly thank you for giving me the opportunity and convincing me to come to the University of Southern Mississippi and laboring at what I do. And I just hope along the way I've made a little difference in the people's lives here, the people's come through here, but even more important, and no disrespect, but to the people with disabilities in the state of Mississippi and around the country. And I am because of what all of you contribute in some way to me, and I want to say thank you.
Now, what is this talk about?
Turn the light.
and we did pay it out of grant either, by the way.
They don't call it motor oil. I was about to say anything, but that never has kept me from not talking. Is it my turn? Yes. Okay. Well, let me thank you for all that you've done. I know you've done more than I know about, and that may be to your advantage. I'm not sure. But I do know this, that you've been a true social worker all my life. Remembering those who need the service and finding a way as best you can, we can, to serve those people who so often are not remembered. And you're a great example of that. I appreciate it. Should I ask the question for the so long house?
Not yet, Douglas.
That's my biggest plan. It's gonna work.
After the martini.
One of the main reason I had heard of Dr. Lucas, everybody knew Dr. Lucas, and though I had great respect for Dr. Sidus, because we had worked together out of the governor's office, and you know, the Lord has a funny way of doing things, because one of the things, and Alma would attest to this, Alma's been with me a long time, and when I was in the governor's office of policy, I structured it in a way that we assigned certain agencies to track in terms of policy to make sure it kind of cohesively followed where the governor wanted things to go. And I always been one to not ask staff to do things I hadn't done, I was not willing to. So I said, well, I'm going to take all the agencies dealing with disability itself. And I didn't know what I was getting into then. I just, you know, trying to show the staff I'm willing to roll up my sleeve and get out there with you. And then from there, it really grew my whole interest. But the most effective thing that got me, and I'm going to lead back to Dr. Lucas here, that really helped me a lot was when I got that call one late afternoon and say, can you arrange a meeting with Governor Mabus to meet with some families? And Jane Sidus called me. And I said, Jane, what are we talking about? You know, you're going to walk in and just get the governor's calendar. And Jane said, well, we need to do it today. We need to do it today. And so I don't know if Jane remember that. I got on the phone, started calling people in the governor's office. We had families driving up. I think you met with about Kathy Old and a number of them. And at that point in time, we had that 3 o'clock that afternoon. We met with Governor Mabus and one of his key advisors. And when those families talked about having to take their children out of state of Mississippi, out from their home to get service. And when I listened to a mom saying, I'm taking my 14-year-old son and put him in a nursing home because I can't lift him anymore and there are no supports out in the community. And I remember driving home that afternoon and I said, you know, I really got to get in this fight. And because I could be one child born away from dealing with those same issues. I could be one accident away from dealing with those same issues. And Dr. Lucas, it wasn't but a year later that I got a call 5:30 one afternoon sitting in my study at home. You called me. You probably don't remember. And Dr. Lucas said to me, he said, Roya, we want you to come to the University of Southern Mississippi and work with the Institute, the Center there. I said, well, Dr. Lucas, I don't know. And I don't know if you remember these words. You got to get in this fight. And I thought back what I thought that afternoon. You know Dr. Lucas, a great salesperson. Great recruiter. And when I hung up the phone, I said, well, Dr. Lucas, I'm getting ready to go to Hungary. I don't know. And he said, well, think about it. You got to get last thing he said to me again. He said, you got to get in this fight. Let me know what you think when you get back. And so I thought about it those 2 weeks I was over there. And that kept ringing my ear, Dr. Lucas, I got to get in this fight. I just can't talk about it. I got to get into it. So I really appreciate you, and I appreciate the distant mentoring that you probably don't even realize you were doing. A lot of us who really saw how you interact in higher ed, how you interact with the legislature, how you interact with state agency.
Especially one state agency.
State agency. But he always did it with grace, as a statesman, and professionally. And I know sometimes I've broke that model, you know, with some staff with him, but I think I've only seen this gentleman angry and upset one time. And even then, he was very much a statement, but he was very firm and straight about what he wanted and what he done. And he's fought tremendously for this institute over the years and hadn't really gotten the credit that he deserved for us. So I want to publicly thank you for both working with the institute, supporting the institute, and serving as a mentor for many of us in Mississippi.
Caller, we were trying to FaceTime. Dr. Kamali is on the line, and I would like to say a few words. So hopefully y'all can hear him. Dr. Kamali?
Hello, everyone.
How you doing? Thank you very much, Dr. Mullins.
Let me give two apologies. Dr. Evelyn Walker, his wife, I apologize that she could not be at this particular event on today. And then Dr. President Bennett talked with his office, and he told me to get the secretary to get it on the calendar. And I tried to, but she had him booked up in Jackson. He was traveling, and so they did send me.
She told me she's somewhere over there. That is one of the hardest working women.
Also, Julie Cook sent her regards. Oh. She was unable to attend.
And Margie Cox. So at this time, we didn't really have a refreshment. But before we do that, any special guests or recognizers here that want to say a word or two to Dr. Walker, we'll allow you the time to do that right now. It's not a yes condolences for sure, but any congratulations on his retirement and his new position. He may do so. Briefly, real quick.
Yeah, we need to reschedule.
Anybody? Before we start networking and kind of mingling and meeting?
I'm going to make y'all accountable to yourself.
No.
I'm not No, I gotta sign this or something.
But we just gotta go ahead and start eating and kind of mix and mingle the caucus as we go, okay? Thank you.
Receiving funding from the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services, Administration on Developmental Law, blah, 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 blah. Together, we can enhance the quality of life of all Mississippians.
Amen.
Bless you. Lay hands on you, mama. I think we need to speed it up a little. I think that's what I'm thinking.
This is Barack Obama. I had to say that.
Yeah. Hope, change.
To Dr. Roy Walker. Well, I never thought this time would come when I would have to formally complain about the man who hired me. But alas, because I'm such a dedicated and committed employee of the University of Southern Mississippi Institute of Disability Studies, I must deviate from my normal, quiet, timid, and sweet demeanor so that the fallacies of this executive director may be known to all who are so dedicated to this grand conglomerate. Honestly, I have so much pent-up frustration that I couldn't possibly take the time necessary to bring to light all of my complaints. So I will just highlight some of the major ones. And I'll be very brief, also because I'm sure that Dr. Lee will want to say something before we leave, and I want to make sure we get back to Jackson before midnight. I start my complaint all the way back to the hiring process. I've never been able to get over the fact that when I first started, I was put through a rigorous hiring process in which I was forced through a gauntlet of intimidating interviews with not only Dr. Walker, but what seemed like the entire staff. And they wanted to see if I would be able to get along with the team, which was a total waste of time because most all of them were quitters and are gone now except a couple. I'm not sure if I had anything to do with their leaving, but I would like to think I played a large role. It at least makes me feel good knowing that I made an impact. But to top off this rigorous process, I remember I was sitting at my desk when I got the call from Dr. Walker offering me the job. As Dr. Walker was going over the numbers with me, a thought popped into my mind. I said to myself, "Self, I believe this man is in the bathroom. I swear I think he told me the amount of money I was going to make when I heard the toilet flush." So being the positive thinker that I am, I did know one thing. He did wash his hands. As I was processing this situation, supersonically of course, because of my brain size, I thought, wow, this man kept saying that this is not the typical cushy government job and that we all work around here. But gee whiz, they never even stopped working even for bathroom breaks. I truly believe this was a calculated plot to make sure that I knew that he expected constant work at all times. This left a permanent impression on me and actually gave me a complex. You see, I've always believed that many times the way you come into a situation is the way you go out. So to this very day, I hear the every time I hear the toilet flush, I get an overwhelming feeling that I'm going to get fired. That is why I've never flushed the toilet at work or washed my hands. This intimidating process did not stop. It continued from the first day I arrived, ready to work. When I got to work, expecting to get after it, I was notified by a very intimidating individual named Mr. Smith that no one would be there for the first week of my employment because they were all at a conference in Washington, and I was left with a bunch of policy books with the instructions to read them all. I felt like I was in the Matrix, and all I can remember about this traumatic experience was a little smirk on Agent Smith's face as he turned to walk out the door. That added to the already current complex, so that was the beginning, and I won't bore you with all the details that came after that, but I will say I also feel that I was misled when I was hired as the associate coordinator for the Neighborhood Stabilization Program for the Institute of Disability Studies, which, by the way, is another complaint I have. Do you have any idea how long it took me to learn my job title? I mean, I had to write it out 100 times just so I could tell people what I do. Also, I was told that this job would be constant work, some long hours, and, quote, I would be building a plane while flying. The problem was that it was so honestly laid out for me, I didn't really believe it. And if I knew that what I was being told was the actual truth, I would have asked for more money. Now, I have to say, it has not been all bad. There are a few things that have impressed me about Dr. Walker, and some things I haven't quite figured out. One example of this is Dr. Walker is a networking magician. I mean, I still can't figure out, for the love of me, why so many people like him. It's the craziest thing I've ever seen. Another skill that I noticed was his ability to build a team of intimidating individuals. I mean, have you ever thought of the fact that his financial guy is named Billy the Tala, who I know has to be related to Attila the Hun because of his aggressive demeanor and intimidating stature? And who else do you know could get a rich baker to do all his computer work? I mean, the man's got skills. But enough of the good stuff. Now back to my complaint. So to add to my complex, which I believe was carefully calculated and planned by the doctor himself, I was constantly put through the demeaning and humiliating process of having to write letters for him. I believe this was a direct retaliatory technique because it only happened when I could cause problems, which were not many, by the way. I believe for some reason he would get upset when he was called at 8 or 9 o'clock at night by Ms. Cowden from MDA. I could tell that he was upset from the tone of his voice when he would call, and instead of saying, "Hey, Jesse, this is Dr. Walker," he would say, "Jesse, what have you done now? Why is she calling me?" I know this was an aggravated tone because it was the same high-pitched tone that I kept hearing when he would say, "Jesse, where am I going to get the money to pay for this? You're killing me." Each time this would happen with no call from me, I would be told to prepare a letter to submit to the VP or MDA. And I know that he was just sitting at his desk snickering, knowing that I was wasting my time putting the letter together. In fact, I believe he even had Miss Alma in on the joke, because when I would submit it for her word magic, I would get it back and I would think to myself, did they even use anything I put in the letter? But again, being the super achiever that I am, I always looking at the positive, I would notice that they would use some of my wording occasionally. For example, I would still see the words "and" or even a "but" every now and again, which was very exciting, by the way. In fact, this was so frustrating, many times I nearly sent a draft letter that said, "Dear Dr. Gordon," then blank space, "Sincerely, Dr. Roy Walker." I never did actually send that to Dr. Walker because, though I am bold, folks, I'm not stupid. Well, I've gone on way too long, and I won't mention many other things like having to work in a hostile environment with subpar peers or even having to work with Dr. Tulio Sobera. In conclusion, I have to be honest for a second, move away from my complaint for just a minute, and say, Dr. Walker, it has been a true honor to work with you. Some of you may not know this, maybe not even you, Dr. Walker, but when I started this job, I was coming off of a very low point in my life. I've been working for myself for a few years, and quite honestly, I was doing very well. In fact, to let everyone know where I was coming from, I went from having a business profiting more every month than my yearly salary here at the Institute. So I'm sure you can imagine it was quite an adjustment for me. To be honest, when I started, I was so disgusted by going broke and working for what I considered chump change at the time that I made my mind up that I was only going to do the minimal amount of work that I had to just to get by. But something happened that I was not prepared for. I saw a man who truly cared about what he was doing, someone who actually was willing to put time in, always working hard, traveling every week, seeing emails that were sent late at night, and I saw a man who truly cared about his integrity and a man with a resolve that I have not seen in a long time, even when his integrity was questioned. I saw an excellent manager who recognized how I worked best, one who gave me instructions then let me run with it. And slowly but surely I noticed a change in my attitude. As time went on, I noticed a small spark of light back in my drive to actually try hard and perform well despite the amount of money, just because that's what I should do. So you may not have noticed because I tried to hide it as much as I could, but I'm not the same man that I was when you first hired me. I was angry, defeated, and broke, but through your example and the opportunity to do this job, I have had a tremendous attitude change, and for that, I'm in your debt. You know, it's funny how God uses people. I was in a very low place, and I believe God used you to help another of his chosen. Thank you, Dr. Walker, for your leadership and your example, and I wish you joy and happiness in retirement and your future. P.S. Don't worry, I've talked with your new employer and told them that you would like to start an NSP 5 program over there, and they were very receptive, so you can jump right in and start on your first day, NSP 5. P.P.S. With all these good words, I should be in position to get a pretty good job when you take Obama's place. Dr. Walker, in all seriousness, I want to be a czar. Thank you.